how many of us know that Israel has just celebrated the Yom Kippur? Yes, just last night it ended. And, you know, 51 years ago when Israel was still a very new nation, a new state, you know, in Israel, in the Middle East, what happened was that they has always, even on the very first day, you know, when Israel was being formed, right, as a nation, all the surrounding nations around, especially the Arab nations, were already, you know, having war with them. And we thank God that God indeed has protected them. And not only that, you know, in the year 1973, they faced one of the most devastating war ever. Why? Because, you know, they were caught off guard. They were caught off guard because, you know, Yom Kippur being one of the holiest festival that is celebrated in Israel. And not only that, it is also during the time of the Ramadan season. So, you know, the intelligence that went out says that it's not likely that there will be a war. It's not likely, you know, that the surrounding nations will come and attack Israel. But then to their surprise, they were just really caught off guard. They were not prepared, and there were at least thousands, 2,000, 3,000, you know, of tanks, of artillery that crosses over the Suez Canal, you know, approaching into Israel. And, you know, the Prime Minister then, who was Golda Meir, she was almost wanting to commit suicide. Why? Because it seems that they, as a state, will they be completely devastated and wiped out from the map of this world. And because the forces that are coming towards them, the Egyptian forces, with all their artilleries, all their armored cars, and all their planes, outnumbered theirs. And not only that, Syria, joint forces. And not only that, they have the support of Russia as well, you know, for this attack. And therefore, you know, she do not know who to turn to. Because at the time, the president of the U.S., which is Richard Nixon, President Richard Nixon is not known, right, to be a president, you know, for his love for the Jewish people. Right, and but then surprisingly, what happened was that on the second day, right, the prime ministers of Israel called the White House, and she contacted Richard Nixon. And she posed a question to Richard Nixon: if Israel will not receive any help, what then will become of Israel? And therefore, the moment when she called her, when she spoke to her, you know, something miraculous happened. It was that suddenly he recalled what his mother has always been telling him when the mother in the days when he was still young has been reading the Bible to him, and especially the Old Testament, talking about all the heroes of the Bibles. And so one afternoon, he told his son, Richard Nixon, he said that, son, one day, you know, you will be in a position, right, that you will be called upon to help Israel. And if that comes about, you must do everything that you can to help Israel. And so that words came to him so clearly that all of a sudden, everything changes. Even in spite of the fact that he knows that there will be an embargo of oil that will be cut off if ever U.S. were to support Israel in this war. In spite of that risk, you know, he went ahead. He went ahead to help and offload, you know, planes and planes of artillery, planes and planes of ammunition, and all the weapons of war to release to Israel. And what happened during that time? You know, it almost turned out to be the Third World War, you know, where nuclear weapons will be used. Why? Because at that time, Russia sent a large warship armed with ballistic missiles and nuclear warheads across the Mediterranean to Egypt in an apparent bid to solve the problem. But likewise, Richard Nixon took action. He called out to 2.3 million of U.S. men on standby, you know, to first alert since the Cuban crisis, the warship, and because of his action, the warship that the Russians sent, you know, they hold back, they retreated, and they anchored out in the Black Sea instead of going towards Egypt. And that really miraculously prevented the Third World War. And not only that, it was during that time, you know, if you remember Rhys Howells, you know, the intercessor in the Bible College in Wales, he was one of the greatest intercessors that we know of. Because of him, you know, the war in Europe was being stopped. That Hitler, you know, with his army that was approaching Britain, right, was suddenly held back because this intercessor was intensively intercessing on their knees. So likewise, Samuel Howell, which is the son of Rhys Howells, felt a strong burden to pray at the time, you know, for Israel. And he has such a burden, you know, in his heart. And he asked the Lord, what is it all about? And the Lord told him, my enemies wanting to advance Armageddon at this time. And we know that the outcome was miraculous, right? The outcome was miraculous. And all it goes to show that God is not finished with Israel yet. Even though Israel, from the very beginning, even though they were being chosen, right, to be the nation that will bring forth the Savior of the world, but yet they have refused, they have rebelled and rejected Jesus as their Messiah. Even though they have turned their back towards Jesus, but God has not left them. God is not finished with Israel yet. Why? Because the Bible tells us in Romans 11 that the gifts and callings of God is irrevocable. It's irrevocable, right? His gifts and his calling, not only just for the nations, but also for individuals, for you and I, right, is irrevocable. Therefore, God will continue to be faithful. He will continue to show his grace upon those that will indeed turn themselves towards him, that will want to receive his grace and his blessings, right? So this is what we see of God, you know, in the time past, and I believe that he is the same God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? Amen. So we know that even now in the U.S., I mean, in Israel, in the Middle East, tension is continuing to build up. Why? Because Israel is planning for a retaliation against Iran because of all the ballistic missiles that were fired towards them. And not only that, now that Hezbollah and all the others, you know, that are continuing even within Gaza itself, right? And it definitely, I believe that all the nations and especially US is trying to find a solution to it so that there will be an agreement, so that there will be peace that will once again return to Israel. And I believe that we are definitely at the crossroad now, right, of time. It's either that the enemy will be able to take advantage of this time, or either that by the grace of God, that it will come to a standstill, it will come to a good closure, right? And that we will continue to have peace again around the world. This morning, we're going to look at Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9, which I entitled it as, Has God Forsaken His Chosen People? Has God forsaken His chosen people? And we know, you know, that it is only by grace. It is only by grace that we will be saved. It is only by His grace. Because so often a time that as human, with that fallen nature in us, we have a tendency to rebel against God. We have a tendency to go to away from Him and against Him. But it is only by His grace that you and I will remain to be saved. Now I want to go back to recap again. Why was the book of Romans written? Why was it written to the church in Romans? As you know, the church in Rome was founded by those Jews who had went to the Pentecost celebration, right, during in the upper room, where they miraculously encounter God there, encounter Jesus. And these are the ones that went back to Rome, right, to found the church. And these are the Jews that have been there. And I believe that, you know, as they, you know, founded the church there, there were also Gentiles, right, that also turned to God, that also received the same blessing. And therefore, it continued to grow in that place. But one day, what happened was that Emperor Claudius decided that he wanted to expel all the Jews from Rome. Why? Because there were news that were telling him that these are the people that had been going around creating problem. And in the name of Jesus, they are the one that has been stirring up the city. And therefore, he wanted them to be get rid of from Rome, right? And because of that, therefore, there is left a vacuum. Why? Because the church in Rome all this while has been receiving its teaching, right, by those Jews, the Jewish of Jewish descendants, teachers and elders of Jewish descendants. They are the one that gave the instruction, especially during their Sabbath day. But suddenly they were all gone. And by the grace of God and with the help of the Holy Spirit, they were able to continue to sustain. They're able to continue their worship in that place and to continue to grow. And so what happened when Emperor Nero decided that he allows the Jews to return? And so when the Jews came back to church, right, but they found themselves to be in an odd place. Doesn't seem to be that they're being welcomed anymore in the church. And therefore, there was a tension arising between the Gentiles and the Jews. And therefore, Paul has to write in book of Rome or of book of Romans to instruct the church over there, right? So that he could able to set things in order and also to resolve the tensions between the new Gentile leadership and the returning Jewish congregants. So we see that Paul started begin by talking about in chapter 1, the depravity of mankind, both Jew and non-Jew, right? And then he also went on to explain, to expound on, you know, justification by faith and faith alone. And he talks about the righteousness of God, what God has done for us so that you and I, that they could receive freely the salvation that is available to them in Christ Jesus, not based on their good works, but based purely on their faith in what God has done, what Jesus has done for them, that they received the blessing. So therefore, they are as Gentiles, they are being grafted into the true vine, right? Even in spite that Israel has rejected Jesus as the Messiah. So now we heard that at the pinnacle, at the climax of his message, of his letters, in chapter 8, he talks about, therefore now there's no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And he ended with saying that there is no more separation of anyone who is in Christ Jesus, right? Nothing could separate you and I from the love of God as long as we are in Christ Jesus. And all of a sudden, you see Paul here, suddenly he switched his message towards explaining, bringing in the Israel into his message. Why? Because I believe that, you know, if Paul were to say that there is no more condemnation and there's no more separation, then what will happen to the Jews? Are they also having the same? Or are they being rejected by God? Are they being forsaken by God because they do not receive Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior? Right? What will happen to them? And so, therefore, Paul got to take these three chapters, chapter 9, chapter 10, and chapter 11, before he went on to talk about the practical living of the Christian life, having heard, having received what are the doctrines of salvation. And here in chapter 9, he expounded the Israel past as God's chosen people. In chapter 10, he will talk about the current state of Israel as one that has rejected God, rejected Christ. And he talks about, in chapter 11, what will be Israel's future state. Will there be a restoration of Israel? And definitely, of course, we know, now that we know that definitely there will be, Israel will once again be restored to the true vine. Though it may not be everybody, it may not be the entire of the whole of Israel, but there will be a remnant of people that will turn their hearts toward God. Just like in the case of the Yom Kippur War, you know, there were many atheists during that time. People in Israel who called themselves Jews that don't believe in God. But because of the war, It was mentioned that at least 2,000 over of them, the soldiers who fought in the war, because they could see, they could recognize the miraculous work of God that protected Israel. And so, therefore, they turned their hearts towards God. So there will always be a remnant that will turn their hearts towards God. So I want to look at this morning, chapter 9, about how God is dealing with Israel that reveals God's characters and God's nature. So from verse 1 to 13, it talks about God's faithfulness. In verse 14 to 18, it talks about His righteousness. And in 19 to 29, it talks about God's justice. And in 30 to 33, it talks about God's grace. Let's read through the verses. Shall we read it together? 1, 2, 3. I'm speaking the truth in Christ. I'm not lying. My conscience bears me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from their race, according to the flesh, is the Christ, who is God over all, blessed forever. Amen. Now, whenever Paul talks about what Christ has accomplished for us, he's always full of excitement and full of joy. But whenever he turned his thoughts towards Israel, it will bring him sorrow, great sorrow, and unceasing anguish, as he says here. Why? Because I believe that Paul, in time past, has faced a lot of rejection from his own people. He's probably been treated as a traitor of their own religion. Why? Because they are the ones that refuse to accept Jesus Christ. But here, Paul has been going around preaching about Jesus Christ, about faith in Christ, and not about the laws, and not about good works that you could able to attain salvation. And therefore, whenever he looked at them, he was full of sorrow. Why? Because just like Moses, when God was about to wipe them off, Moses stand before God and told him that before he do that, to erase his name from his book and not the names of the fellow Jews. So likewise here, Paul was also in that same position, that if only he could ask God, right, to stand on behalf, to be accursed, and to be cut off from Christ for the sake of his brethren, he would want to be able to do that as well. So this is such the heart of Paul, one that really carries the burden of the Lord Jesus Christ for his people. Don't forget that Jesus was born as a Jew. He was among them. And so therefore, Paul brought out to say that, no, they are the Israelites. They are the chosen people of God. God from the very beginning has called them out especially to be his special possession, right? And adopted them as his sons, as his people. You know, he sent Moses to tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Israel is my firstborn. And therefore, God has adopted them to be his sons and daughters. And the glory belongs to them as well. Why? Because from the very beginning, the glory of God has been with them. Has been with them whenever they go, when they were being delivered out of Egypt. The glory of God went together with them as the pillar of fire and as a cloud at night to shadow them, as the cloud in the day and as the pillar of fire in the night. And not only that, his glory was among them in the tabernacle, in the temple. And the covenants, they are the people that receive the covenants from God directly. Right? When God called out Abraham from the land of Ur, the Chaldeans, he made a covenant with him to say that out from him will come nations. Nations. And not only that, there was also the Mosaic covenant that was given, that the laws were being given to them. And also there were the Davidic covenant that was given to them, that out of that there will be a kingdom that will remain forever, and out of the lineage of David will come the Savior. The giving of the law, the worship, they were given the privilege to able to worship, to ministers, to serve in the temple of God, where the presence of God is. and also the many promises that were given to them. If they were to obey, they shall be blessed. They shall be blessed. They will enjoy the very blessings of God. You know, they will be the head and not the tail. They shall be the top and not the bottom. And to them belongs the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. And from their race, according to the flesh, is the Christ who is God over all. So you see how privileged they are as a chosen people, that God has earmarked them, that God has chosen them, that God has put his blessings over these people. And yet, they choose to refuse the Lord Jesus Christ as their Messiah. Therefore, the question then goes on to us, has the word of God failed? In spite of all this, have the word of God failed? And apparently, Paul says, let it not be so. For all that who are descended from Israel, not all, for not all who are descended from Israel belongs to Israel. So he wants them to know that even though God has chosen the Jews to be his own people, but then not all of them are really the Jews. Not all of them. Why? Because he says that not all are children of Abraham because they are his offspring, but through Isaac shall your offspring be named. Because Isaac is the only promised child that God has covenanted, that God has promised Abraham and Sarah. And this means that it is not the children of the flesh who are the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted as offspring. Why? Because at that time, before Isaac was Ishmael. Ishmael was the son of the flesh, not the son of the promise. Therefore, it is not the chosen one. Even though by birthright, by tradition, the elders should be able to be the one that shall inherit all the blessings and all the inheritance and that are the estates that are to be given, right? But it is not by natural descent that they will automatically receive the blessing. It is only the children of promise that will receive the blessings. And this is what the promise says: about this time next year, I will return and Sarah shall have a son. You know, God has a sense of humor when he took Abraham and Sarah out from the land of Chaldeans. Why? Because they are at their old age. And here you have, when God promised that Abraham and Sarah will have a son, they could not fathom in their mind, at this age, how could it be possible? You know, where all the organs are closing down already, are stopping their manufacturing operations. How could it be possible that they could able? And that is for that very purpose that God wants them to know that it is not out of your capability, out of your own performance, that you will receive the blessings, that you will receive the promise. It is only by the very act, by the very grace of God, that they will receive the blessing. And so God waited and waited until he is almost 100 years old, that he knows that by his own ability, he will not be able to conceive a child. And then the miracles took place. And not only so, but also when Rebecca has conceived children by one man, our forefather Isaac, though they were not yet born and had done nothing, either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, not because of works, but because of him who calls. She was told, the older will serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob I love, but Esau I hated. So you see here, the same thing is being explained. It is by human nature, right? At the time, Rebecca conceived twins, Jacob and Esau, or Esau and Jacob. And Esau came out being the older and Jacob being the younger. And yet, the blessings was given not to Esau, which is by tradition, by nature, natural descendant, it shall go to Esau being the elder. But yet, God decided from the very beginning, even before they have proven themselves, whether they are good or bad, God has already decided for the purpose of election that might continue, for the purpose of choosing them for to display and to do his goodwill and his purpose here on earth. You see, when God chose, when God elect, not that he will choose one and neglect the others. But it was for the purpose that the one that he had chosen were able to bring out and display and perform the purpose that he had chosen. So that others, those around them, those that around him, will be able to see the goodness of God in his life. And they too will want to turn towards the living God. That was for the very purpose of election. Right? It's not that God would want to neglect the rest, but he would also want to be able to bless each and every one of them as well. But he needs someone. Therefore, he had chosen the person to be his representative, to display his goodness in their lives, so that others will be jealous. Just like the Bible tells us, God has chosen us Gentiles, right? Has given us all the blessings so that, you know, in all that we are, as we live out the very blessings of God in our lives, that the Jews will be jealous, that they also would want the same blessings. So we can see here that God do not, his selection does not depend on our performance. It is all determined by his sovereign will, by his sovereign will that he choose, that he decide, and it is only by grace, right? That the older will serve the younger. So when it says that Jacob I love, but Esau I hated, sometimes, of course, it's very difficult for us to really understand, you know, that why God only loved Jacob and hated Esau. But the word hated actually doesn't mean that God hates him totally, but he is less loved by God. He's less favored by God. Now, if you will look into the story of Jacob and Esau, or Esau and Jacob, finally, when the two brothers met, right, what did Jacob brought with him? You know, because he was so afraid of his own life. He was so frightened because he knew that he had deceived his brother to take away his blessing, right, as the firstborn. And so when he finally had the opportunity to meet up with his brother to amend, know their relationship, what did he bring with him? He brought with him a great big gift, right? To appease his brother Esau. Right? And he sent his family ahead so that, you know, they will not be destroyed if ever the brother were to recall and were to, you know, kill them. And he brought with him 500 animals to be given as a gift to his brother Esau. And what did Esau say? No, brother, you can keep your gift. I am just as blessed. I am just as blessed. He has hundreds of servants with him that came with him. You know, so Esau, not that he did not have the blessing of God, he too, when Isaac blessed them, Isaac also gave a blessing to Esau as well, right? And therefore, we know that God, in his goodwill, in his heart, is not that he would choose one and neglect the others, but he will, through one, be able to also similarly bless the others. God is not unfair in his treating with men, in his dealing with men, Therefore, God's plan for salvation is not based on natural descent nor tradition of man. It is not based on human merit or performance, character or conduct. God loves everyone. He favored one so that he could reveal his goodness to all. God do not condemn anyone. I think it is very important for us to know that God do not, even in the election, he didn't elect them for condemnation. He only elect them for salvation, right? Nowhere in the Bible it tells us that God has chose somebody to be condemned in their life. No one. Nowhere in the Bible will you be able to find that. God do not condemn anyone. He reserved the right to choose who he wants to bless to fulfill his purpose. Even though Israel failed, God remained faithful to his word, to his plan of salvation for mankind. Then he went on to say, what shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then, it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, and that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then, he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. Is God fair? Is God just? Is God righteous in his dealing? How could he favor one and not favor the other? Why can't he treat everybody the same? Is God unrighteous? So, of course, Paul went to defend. You say that, now, look, if God were to, based on righteousness, to treat everybody, then none of us were able to deserve anything from God because of our fallen nature, because of our rebellion. If God were to use the basis of righteousness to treat each and every one of us, we will all fail. And we will all not be able to receive his blessing. And therefore, God in his goodness, he reminded the people. It was at Mount Sinai, when God was giving the Ten Commandments to Moses, the fellow Jews, the Israelites, were having a wild party at the foot. So much so that they gotten Aaron to build an idol of gold, a calf made out of gold, and then they worship. And God has told them that they shall not have any other gods. But yet, in their rebellious nature, they went against God. And so much so that Moses got to plead for on their behalf. Before you wipe them off, remove my name. And what happened? If God were to treat them based on righteousness, their righteousness, all of them will be gone. All of them will be dead. He will send his plague to kill every one of them. But yet, in his mercy, he only killed 3,000 of them. Of all, out of all, God only removed 3,000 of them, because God is a God of justice, that he, in his justice, will have to do something against the sin that was committed. So then it depends not on human will exertion, but on God who has mercy. And he went on to say that if you were to look at the life between Pharaoh and Moses, he have chosen both of them, right? Pharaoh at the time was, and Egypt was, one of the most powerful force, military force on earth. Pharaoh, when he was being approached by Moses to let the people go, what did Pharaoh say? Who is this God that I shall obey him? I'm the greatest ruler here on earth of the empire of the Egyptian. Who is this God that I must obey him? And God, the very purpose that why God has raised him up for such a time as this, is so that through Pharaoh, that he may display his power. Even though no matter how powerful Pharaoh and his armies are, God was able to use that for his purpose, to accomplish his purpose, so that indeed what he says, that my name might be proclaimed through all the earth. That my name will be proclaimed to all the earth. So you see that God's heart is that even out of something that is not good, he would want to be able to use it for his good purpose, that many will turn their hearts to him. And you could remember Rahab in the city of Jericho, you know, far away from Israel, have heard the name of God, has heard the miraculous act of God that has brought Israel out of Egypt, that has opened up the Red Sea. And she have heard of the mighty act of God, and therefore she was the one that was also included into God's family, right? So that was the very purpose of God, that his name be proclaimed throughout the earth. And therefore, so that he has mercy on whoever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. Now you see that in the case of Pharaoh, not that he wasn't given the opportunity to soften his heart so that he could receive the blessing of God. For many times, one after another, right, the plague that God has brought about. But yet, at every of this plague, Pharaoh's heart was hardened even more. So the Bible tells us that, you know, in many occasions, it says that Pharaoh hardened his heart. And in another occasion, it says, and God hardens Pharaoh's heart. God hardened Pharaoh's heart because Pharaoh already decided that he will not give up to God, that he will continue to rebel against God. And therefore, God confirmed it, hardened it. The same, like it says, the same sunlight that shines on the snow, that melts the snow, that melts the ice, the same sunlight also hardens the clay. So it depends on how we receive it. If we receive it negatively, if we choose that we will want to go our own way, that our ways is higher than his way, then we have to face our own consequences. Right? God acts with mercy to all who would respond to him. Mercy is not getting what we do deserve. Mercy is given or shown not based on human merit or performance. God's sovereign act is that his name might be proclaimed in all the earth. You know, when I think of God's mercy, I always think of our good friend, our brother, Mango. Right? You know, he used to tell me that he comes from a broken family, a dysfunctional family. You know, he lost his mother when she gave birth to the younger daughter. And because of that, the father went out to look for another wife, and this wife came with his own children into the house. And, you know, Mango said that he could not take it. And then he went out and he, you know, stayed with the grandma. And then the uncle took advantage of him, you know, used him like a slave and to work, you know, for him with very small return. And, of course, he ended up with gangsterism, with the gangsters out there. Now, when he was being approached, when he was being brought with the good news, Mango could either reject it, right, or be angry about it. Who is this God? Why do I have to suffer all this while? Right? He could harden his heart and not receive the goodness of God, the blessing of God. But yet, because he decided that he won, you know, to want to turn his heart towards to God. And then from that time onwards, you find that he was in such joy and happiness because he continued to receive the many blessings of God. Just recently, he texted me. You know, he received from the insurance company 8,000 plus for the incident that happened to him. You know, that he was injured at the workplace and he could able to claim $8,000. He was full of joy. He could pay up for whatever, you know, whatever expenses he still needed to. So you can see that, you know, when we decided to pursue after God, when we soften our hearts to obey God, we will receive his blessings. Right? So God does not go around hardening man's heart, but you and I have a choice. You and I have a choice to make. You will say to me, then why does he still find fault? For who can resist his will? But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Well, what this molded says to its molder, why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? What if God, desiring to show his wrath and to make known his power, has endured very much patient vessels of wrath prepared for destruction in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy which he has prepared beforehand for glory. Why does he still find fault? So from a human perspective, we would question, if it's God who is the one who orchestrates, who select, who elect, and who make all this, why am I still responsible for my action? Why does he still find fault with me? Isn't it all because that it was his decision, his will? But then why? Why am I still whole responsible for my decision? And of course, Paul explained, look, you and I, it's just like the clay in the potter's hand. The potter has the right to decide whether you should be made a vessel of honor or it should be one that will be of dishonorable use. One like that of a spitten. No, where people spit into it. Dishonorable use. But who are you to question God? God has all the right to decide what we should be. But you are to be responsible. Because you have a choice. See, the clay may not have a choice. But when God created us, he created us with a free will, with a choice. Right? And therefore, you and I are to take responsibility for our decision. For whatever decision that we are to make, you are responsible. So likewise, it says that it is God who foreknew. And because he foreknew, he therefore foreordained. He predestined. And then he called. Now the calling is up to you. Whether you will receive his calling or not, you have the right to make that decision. God will not force that upon you because he has given you the free will to choose. And therefore, you and you alone shall be responsible for every decision that you make. God will not be held responsible. Do you understand that? Amen? So therefore, it is important for us to know that we have a part to play. That we have a part to play in every of this decision. What if God, desiring to show his wrath, once again, here Paul is bringing back the case of the Pharaohs. You know, God has been enduring all this while because, you know, he has heard the cry of his people, the cry of his people that were being slaves and slaves in Egypt has risen up to him. And he heard their cry, and therefore he called out to Moses, and he sent Moses to go and deliver his people. He has endured that with patience, right? Not that he enjoys seeing his people suffering, but he endured. So why? It says that, so that endured with much patience the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction. The vessel of wrath, because see, God, as what it says to us in the book of Peter, you know, that God is slow, right? Why? Because it is for your good and for my good. So that, you know, that he would give sufficient time for you and I to be able to respond to him, right? He does not act immediately, but he is full of patience. He's waiting for you to turn your mind, to change your mind so that you will want to choose what is right and not what is wrong. But in this case, Pharaoh has already decided upfront from the very beginning that he will not obey God, and therefore he has chosen the path that he became the vessels of wrath, that the wrath of God will come and pour upon him and upon all the Egyptians, right? But in so doing, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, for those, you know, who will turn their hearts towards him. And I believe that when the Jews, when the Israelites left Egypt, there were also others, Egyptians, that went along with them, right? That those that hearken, that those who know that this is the true and living God, they also. You see, as long as, you know, as it says that, you know, when the angel of death passed by, right? As long as whoever, whether be it a Jew or whether be a Gentile or whether be a slave, that as long as they are inside the house where the doors are being covered by the blood, they will be saved. They will be saved, right? They will not be the vessels of wrath, but rather they will be the vessels of mercy which God has prepared beforehand for glory. Even us whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles. You and I are prepared to be vessels of blessings, vessels of mercy, so that you and I will receive the glory of God. And indeed, he says in Hosea, those who were not my people, I will call my people, and her who was not beloved, I will call beloved, and in the very place where it was said to them, you are not my people, there they will be called sons of the living God. And Isaiah cries out concerning Israel, though the number of sons of Israel will be as the sand of the sea only, a remnant of them will be saved. For the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth fully and without delay. And as Isaiah predicted, if the Lord of hosts had not left us offspring, we would have been like Sodom and become like Gomorrah. You know the story of Hosea. Hosea being the prophet, you know, he was called to do a strange thing. Was probably not in the mind of any of the prophets. He was called to go and look for a prostitute and to marry the prostitute and to have children. So as to show the rebellious nature of the Israel people themselves, so that they could visually see for themselves how rebellious they are. They have not chosen to follow after God. They have chosen to go their ways. But yet God has mercy upon them. He knows that one day he will still keep a remnant of people that will give themselves unto him. Right? And that is exactly what will happen. It's just like, you know, when Elijah, you know, was hiding in the cave and God asked him, what are you doing here? It's only me and me alone that are left here. You know, but God told him, I have 7,000 other people, remnant, they have yet to bow their feet, they are new to Baal. Right? There will be always be a remnant of people that God will keep, that God will protect, that God will secure. So God is the master potter. As the clay, we either accept his will or we could reject and face our own consequences and be responsible for them. For everyone who accepts his calling, he has prepared for them to show forth his glory. His intent is that all may come to the saving knowledge of Jesus, both Jews and Gentiles. His thoughts for us is always good. There shall be one new man that will come forth as what the Lord has wanting, has achieved on the cross. Finally, What shall we say? The Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained it, that is, a righteousness that is by faith. But that Israel who pursued a law that would lead to righteousness did not succeed in reaching that law. Why? Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as if it were based on works. They have stumbled over the stumbling stone, as it is written, "Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone of stumbling and the rock of offense, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame." So you can see the paradox here. The paradox of the Gentiles that do not have the law, but yet they who did not pursue righteousness, they are the one that in the end found it, received it, because they, by faith, believe it. But the Jews, in all their practices, in all their knowledge, in all the laws that they are the guardians, decided to choose otherwise. They are so uptight in their mind that only they believe that only the law is the path to righteousness. They could not see for themselves. Even when Christ was right in the center, in the middle of them, he could not see the grace that was in their midst. And they missed it altogether. And therefore, they decided that they would want to attain righteousness by their own self-will, by their own righteousness, that they believed that they could fulfill and receive the blessing. But you and I know that it is in the end, it is only by faith that we could receive all that God has designed or has promised for us. For he who comes to God, the Bible says, must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. It is by faith and faith alone. And it's the Bible that says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith, we will not be able to receive what God has planned or purpose for us. So in these last days, even as Pastor James has preached in the WTC, in these last days, we need the kind of faith that could able to move mountains. The Bible tells us one of the heroes, his name was Enoch, that my grandson has but given that same name, Enoch. It says that Enoch walked with God. You know, and not only that, Enoch pleased God, and Enoch had faith in God. Enoch pleased God so much so that he did not have to face death, that he was taken up to walk with God. It's only by faith, when we have faith to believe in God, that we please him. Because when we have faith, when we receive by faith, when we hear what God would want us to do, and we step out in faith to fulfill it, God will be pleased. Because you choose to obey him by faith. Salvation is available to all freely. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourself. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. God does not save people on the basis of birth or their performance. The question is not if we are among God's elect. We just need to make the decision to accept Jesus. So if you are wondering, if you are seated here and you're wondering, am I one of the elect? Am I one of the chosen one? You know, all you have to do is just to open your heart and receive the gift. And then you will know that you are the chosen one, that you are the elect. It is only when you make that decision to invite Jesus into your life, only then you know for sure that you are elect of God. Not when you do not make the decision. You will never know. But it's only when you open up your heart. So if there is anyone among us that have yet to open up your heart to receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, this is the time, this is the moment that you would want to find out for yourself that you are called by God, that you are chosen by God, that you are elected by God. Only if you are willing to open your heart, because the free gifts of God of salvation is freely open to all, to open to anyone that would want to choose to go to receive Him. Divine sovereignty and human responsibility, they work both hand in hand. So in closing, what are some of the applications that we could bring with us? You know, I believe that Paul, he carries such a burden of these people, the burden of God for his people. You know, that so much so that he's willing even to spare his own life, spare his not only his own life, but also his eternity for his people, right? That he be cursed, and so that they will be able to receive the blessings. Because these are his fellow men. They were lost. They have rejected Jesus as their Savior. They are like sheep without a shepherd. And I believe that just like Paul, you and I, the church, owns a big debt to the Jews. And that is exactly what Paul says in chapter 11. For just as you, Gentiles, were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience. So they, the Israel, too, have now been disobedient in order that by your mercy that you have received, shown to you, that they also may now receive mercy. Therefore, you and I own a big debt to Israel, to the Jews. So often, we alienate ourselves from the Jewish people. And now is the time that we really need to show our mercy to the Jewish people. Because they are definitely facing a lot of challenges in all fronts. Now, why we need to bless them? Because I believe that the church needs the Jewish people to come into their destiny. Because the Bible says that it's now, if by their rejection, you and I has benefited so much, the church has become so good, so strong, and received all the blessings. If they were to turn to God, if they were to receive Jesus Christ, how much more do you think that we will be receiving the blessing, the fullness of the blessing? So you and I will need them to come in, to step into their destiny, to receive Jesus so that we would become one new man and that we will rise to be the tallest mountain that the world will be able to see. You and I need Israel. We need each other and they need you, right? To be able to show your mercy to them so that they will see and be jealous. You must rise to your fullness. You must be the church that God has destined you to be so that you could display His manifold wisdom and blessing to the Jewish people. Israel needs the Gentiles church. We therefore need to show mercy to Israel. Showing love to the Jews scattered around the world and Israel. Praying for Israel because they are sheep without a shepherd and they are vulnerable to all the destructive plans. And church must come together in oneness and love for one another that will bring them to jealousy. And I think that until and unless we become one, we will not be able to see the fullness of the blessings, the fullness of what God would want us to be. We must be one, that the world will see that we are sent by the Father. And I believe that's the second thing that we can take away is that without faith, it is impossible to please God. They that comes to God must believe that He is. And how does faith come about? The Bible says that faith comes about by the hearing of the word. The hearing of the word of Jesus. So I want to encourage you. Next Saturday, we're going to rerun the recording of BSSR. Bible speed reading. It is that you will be trained, that you will take on to able to listen to the word of God yourself. Because this program, this teaching, this equipping will enable you to hear, listen the word of God as you look at the words and hear in, because there will be the audio Bible that will be reading aloud to you, and you are to focus on the words and you are to go on your knees. Go on your knees. Why? Because by going on your knees, you are lifting up, you are honoring the word of God in His presence. And by doing so, when you go and when you do that multiple of times, many times, 30, 60, 100 times, the word naturally gets into you. And what you want is that that word, that Logos word, becomes Rhema words to you. And when that comes Rhema words to you, when you step out in faith, in obedience, you will be pleasing God. Amen? So I want to encourage you, if you have not know about this, come this Saturday and learn the breakthroughs that you have brought about to many people by doing this program. So let us rise. I want to encourage us this morning. Can we spend some time just to pray? Pray for Israel. Pray for the peace of Israel. Right? In your own groups, can you maybe pair up with one or two person? No, pray for Israel at this time, you know, during this crucial time that they are facing. Right, yeah. And also we want to ask that you pray for the people of Israel that they will come to know their Messiah. Right, and also that the borders will be secured and for Jerusalem to be protected from being divided. And for the friends and the enemies, that they will come to know that whoever were to bless Israel, that they will be blessed. And whoever go against, curse Israel, that they will be cursed. And that God will keep His watchful eyes over His people. Shall we pray? Shall we just pair up one or two person, you know, to pray and ask the Lord to even as the church, we own a big debt to God, to not only to God, but own the big debt to the Israel, to the Jews. So will you take this time just to pray? Pray among yourself for the peace of Jerusalem. Lord, your word tells us that if I were to forget Jerusalem, Lord, you will not forget Jerusalem. Your eyes are always upon your land upon your people. So as we come this morning, hear our cry, hear our prayer. Lord, even as we ask of you, and Lord, we ask for the peace and the salvation of Israel. Lord, may your hand of protection, may the wings of the Almighty overshadow your people and overshadow your land. Oh God, Father, you who are the Prince of Peace, we ask the Lord that indeed may you bring peace to Israel and to the surrounding region. Lord, we pray that your mighty sovereign hand will reign and rule at this time. The Lord, that indeed let your will be done. Let not the enemy, Lord, yes, steal away. Lord, yes, hijack what that, Lord, that you have already planned and purposed for Israel. Let there be peace again. Lord, we pray that indeed your people, we desire with all our heart, just like Paul, to say that, Lord, save them. Let your people come to know you, Jesus, as their Messiah, that they will be able to step into their destiny.